Good evening. My name is Catherine Rukert, and I'm the president of the Cal Poly College Republican Club. I would like to start off by going over a few housekeeping items, and then we'll get this show on the road. Does it sound like a plan? Yeah, it's about time. Yeah. So just a brief outline of the event tonight. First, there's going to be a short introduction video. Then the guest is going to take the stage, make a speech. Then, depending on how much time remains, we'll go into a Q&A session. So if you haven't done so already, please take the time to silence your cell phones. Also note that flash photography is not allowed, as it is distracting to the speaker. As previously mentioned, there will be a question and answer period after our speaker's lecture. At that time, we ask that people raise their hands and remain in their seats, and a mic will come to you. Please keep in mind that the mics are the only way that your questions will be heard, so shouting from your seat is kind of unnecessary. And on that note, may I remind you that security for this event is extensive, and that disturbances will... Yeah. So disturbances will not be tolerated, as they can result in a removal from the event. And on that note, exits are on either side of the stage and behind you. On behalf of the entire club, I would like to welcome each of you to tonight's event. I would also like to take this opportunity to sincerely thank those who have worked tirelessly to ensure this event's success. We'd like to extend our thanks to the Cal Poly Administration and Student Affairs for their support. To David Beals and all the Spanos Theatre staff for not only providing us with a tremendous venue, but for equipping us for an amazing show. We would like to thank our donors, as well as our active club members and community members, for it is your support that has fueled our ability to host this speaker. And to our club advisor, Dr. Brian Kennelly, thank you for your wisdom, your guidance, but most importantly, your tenacity. For the countless hours of security and logistics planning and for its execution, we owe a great thanks to Chief Hughes and the University Police Department, as well as the other police and security units present to ensure everyone's safety. A round of applause. Yeah. This event was not an easy task, but we've had the privilege with working with incredible individuals who have helped us maintain our platform for freedom of speech. It is that same platform that has enabled tonight's speaker rapid rise in popularity. As a senior tech editor for Breitbart News, he became known as a free speech fundamentalist and a leading critic of the systematic censorship found on college campuses. He has branded himself as the most fabulous supervillain on the internet. A brand that represents a notion of political incorrectness, an idea that is refreshing to some and distressing to others. Regardless of your personal opinions, tonight's event is sure to be an entertaining spectacle from an undeniably charismatic individual. So we ask all of you to listen, contemplate, question, but most importantly, to laugh. Because to quote tonight's speaker, laughter is the sound of freedom. Also, if you don't, he'll probably tell you to do so anyways. So please join me in welcoming the dangerously fabulous Milo Yiannopoulos.
Idiot.
You don't.
Really. a flavor of his work, here are a few headlines. And I'm not making this up. Birth control makes women unattractive and crazy. Would you rather your child had feminism or cancer?
Thank you so much. Thank you. Now, just one thing before I start. I hate to contradict my gracious hosts, but flash photography is absolutely allowed. Just give me a heads up so I can give you my good side, okay? Just give me a little notice and then we're fine. Don't worry about it. Other than that, wonderful. Thanks so much for Cal Poly Republicans for having me and the various groups involved. Thank you. Now. Well, thanks. It's going to be more serious speech than is often given at these things. But to begin with, congratulations to the people in the front row who received some signed and numbered memorabilia this evening. Look forward to that showing up on eBay. by the way, they're edition numbers, not ratings, because I'm not a liberal. I'm not in the business of ranking abortions for how awesome they are. So it's more of a limited edition number rather than a sort of grade, you know? I'm happy that the final week of my tour, this is the penultimate show. Tomorrow, Berkeley, that's it. It's over. Dangerous Faggot Tour is done. But I sort of feel like California's home. And of course, I'm British, but I do feel Californian inside. Well, I feel Californians inside. a couple. I don't know if trans Californian is a thing. I mean, it's sort of the beauty of liberal identity politics is that no matter how insane it is, if you imagine it, it can be true. Internet pornography, transgender pronouns, or Amy Schumer's sex appeal. You can't blame anyone for being trans-Canadian. You have beautiful weather, incredible forests and natural beauty, and plenty of completely insane liberals to laugh at. They're completely nuts. I mean, this is one of the craziest states in America. It's fantastic, but I hope you don't... I was going to say, I hope you don't leave the United States, but I do sort of want to see Calexit happen. It would be something similar to Scottish independence, wouldn't it? This sort of like very feisty, principled, ultimately boneheaded desire for independence, followed by desperate crawling back and begging for readmission. Like me in the establishment club. Now, they say Californian girls are the most attractive women in all of America. And I wouldn't know. I'm gay, did you know? I wouldn't know, but I might do soon. If I'm a little jumpy this evening, by the way, it's because I'm just fresh from my latest electroshock therapy session. The Vice President Mike, if you like the cock, you'll get a shock, Pence. He sent me some vouchers. You see, it's like tanning. It costs less if you buy a course. And there's some very good places in California, so I'm freshly back. Now, I'm not quite cured yet. I'm not quite lusting for snatch. But I do feel guilty every time I look at Idris Elba. Idris Elba, incidentally, is an anagram. If you rearrange the letters, they spell, "You'll never be James Bond." There we go, somebody got it. All right, now before we get to the fun stuff, I have an important announcement to make. My initiative to help white men further their education is now accepting applications. We've given it the brilliant name of the Yiannopoulos Privilege Grant. Now I've called it the, no, no, really, this isn't a joke, this is a real thing. This is an actual charity I set up. It started as a joke. It began as a joke. Well, all these sort of, you know, if you're a woman, if you're black, if you're disabled, if you're Muslim, if you're a refugee, if you identify as an attack helicopter, you can get free money. But the facts say, actually, that it is young white boys who are educationally underprivileged, as educationally underprivileged as many other groups. So it did start as a joke. But nobody can resist the truth wrapped in a good joke, and there's nothing better than doing good while annoying the left. It is my favorite thing. So I and a number of private donors have created this this thing, and we are announcing today, actually as I speak to you, the website is going live, and I, by the way, I called it the Yiannopoulos Privilege Grant because, well, when I started the idea, we got a lot of hate mail, and I thought, well, progressives are not only too stupid to spell Yiannopoulos, but too lazy to look it up. So when we added the Yiannopoulos in there, it cut the abuse in our email accounts by about 97%. Now, as of this second, the website is live. You can apply at privilegegrant.com. My goal is to help more men, no matter what their major or political opinions, reach their educational goals. You can even major in gender studies. I don't care. I mean, I care, but you'll still get the money. I just reserve the right to go into the database, see what people majored in, and laugh at you in public. Our pilot grant program, just to make sure that everything is working and operational, will begin with 10 students. We're going to give $2,500. It's not the biggest grant in the world, but it is by no means the smallest. We're going to give $2,500 to 10 students. It will be paid directly to your college or university, so you can't spend it on coke and hookers. Sorry, the lawyer said I had to. And the grant is open to US citizens attending a 2-year community college or a 4-year college or university course. So if you're at community college doing a thoroughly respectable real trade rather than wasting your life on a subject ending in studies. Anyone here doing a subject ending in studies? Good, no, thoroughly sensible audience. You're all doing engineering and maths, great. Give yourselves a round of applause. Anyway. The most important details are the dates. Submissions applications open today, January 31st, and they close February the 14th, Valentine's Day, which is the day that fat people stock up on razor blades. So, you know, this February 14th, once you've finished crying and wanking and thinking about how alone you are, log on to privilegegrant.com and get yourself some free money. Except I don't advise that you leave it until that late because, not like an essay, you actually have to do something for this. You'll be writing a mini essay and providing a video clip of up to 90 seconds via one of several private upload options, so you're better off starting early. Now, although it took longer than I anticipated to set up the Privilege Grant, your government really does fucking suck. I'm happy that we're now well on our way to helping some young men achieve their dreams. I hope everyone eligible in the room applies, everyone listening at home applies. Men, as you may know, make up only 43% of America's 20.5 million college students. Yet another way in which the feminist consensus about the oppressive patriarchy simply doesn't bear any relation to the facts. And that number's getting smaller. So it's all very well for social justice warriors and progressives to cry and scream and bawl at perceived injustices and talk about changing things and making a difference and, you know, standing up. You go, sister. But then there are those of us who are actually doing something for what is now, at least in higher education, a minority group. You're a minority group anyway, boys. 49% of the population. They don't mention that, do they? Since the 1980s, you might know that women have performed better in high schools and earned the majority of BA degrees. Women have done better at college for a very, very long time, assisted, no doubt, by the dozens of scholarships that are available to them, even if they study ridiculous subjects. Young adults with a bachelor's degree earn 62% more than young people with only a diploma, and the number of jobs that requires a degree has doubled since... Actually, I can't remember since. But it was recently. Now, Cal Poly, see, I don't have a perfect rhyme. Cal Poly. It is actually my kind of school. So many universities that I visit boast about boring alumni, People who have been at the college sort of, or the university trades off for decades. Dull people like pioneering surgeons and Olympic athletes. But you've got Weird Al Yankovic. And it just gets better. It gets better because notwithstanding the general statistics I just gave you, this campus, by higher education standards, is a veritable sausage fest. 53% male. Remarkable. Bucking the national trend, possibly because you study real subjects here. And in fact, women were banned from Cal Poly from 1930 until 1956. For that brief, did you say 57? Oh, sorry. Fucking hell. Academic year? Fine, I value accuracy, I'm grateful. For that brief, blissful quarter century, Cal Poly was a male-only safe space. Like a country club or a Saudi Arabian highway. You see, sometimes people arrive at the right conclusions for the wrong reasons. Their road traffic statistics must be the envy of the world. You ever heard of an accident in Riyadh? Neither have I, aside from Islam itself. Now, you shouldn't encourage me. Now, I want you to be all to be honest for me just for a second. I won't tell anyone, I promise. Don't you, when you hear about the latest harpy outbreak on campus, the latest bloated, bespectacled, blue-haired, facially pierced, lesbianic outbreak. Like those nice people outside just now. Don't you too wish for those halcyon days of 1930 to 1956? I know I do. Another outbreak of fake rape claims, perhaps? For those thinking yes, don't worry, you're not alone. And for the women in attendance, I'm kidding, but only slightly. I know you feel the same horror we do at the antics of your sisters, the less educated sisters of yours out there screeching about something. Incidentally, the left is the only place that knows where to buy swastika flags. I'm sure there must be some sort of underground trade in these things. And if you were to ask, they are sold exclusively to social justice warriors protesting nothing. Wait, I mean, how long has he been president? 8, 9 days? Where are the right-wing death squads we were promised? I thought we were just going to be gunning people down in the street. Instead, he's fixing immigration, fixing trade, cracking down on political correctness, appointing people to... Very disturbing. I thought this was going to be the end of America as we know it. Sadly, he just seems to be a Republican. There's even more to love than the gender imbalance at Cal Poly. Just kidding. You have a freedom of speech loving president, which you should be very happy about. Now, I can't applaud him for his taste in neckties. That thing is absolutely heinous. But, in addition to having a very fetching tan, President Armstrong has made the brave decision, and it is brave these days, to stand against the speech-hating crybabies, the bullies, and the losers of the forces of social justice. And he does deserve a round of applause for that. He has decided... He has decided to follow the path of the University of Chicago and not the University of Missouri. President Armstrong put out a definitive statement about tonight's event, and he hasn't budged an inch. Here's what he said. It is, in fact, the university's responsibility to support the rights of all people to express their opinions and ideas, regardless of how unpopular they may be. Well, fortunately, I'm very popular, so it's okay. Don't worry about it. Don't worry, but thanks. While also encouraging students to think critically and independently, protecting freedom of speech is not an option. It is a critical responsibility that the university and all of us as members of a democratic society must defend. Now, this sort of statement doesn't strike many of us as particularly objectionable or controversial. It's almost funny that it has to be said at all in a country with the First Amendment. But the left doesn't like free speech very much, and the reason for that is they can't win on an even playing field. They cannot win in the arena of facts and logic and reason. They can't win if you are allowed to speak fully, freely, and as loudly and obnoxiously and outrageously as they do, which is why I do, and why they hate me so much. They can't win if the playing conditions are fair, and that's why they hate free speech. That's the same thing, some of the tactics to try and close you down, you know, calling everyone Nazis. And the two things that have happened with Trump, and with me a little too, which I found interesting, is two sort of slippery things. The first is they try to characterize speech as violent or dangerous. And this is the basis of safe space, you know? The idea that some fag from England could represent a threat to student safety is preposterous as it sounds. But you see, what they're doing is if they can muddy the waters between speech and action, they can legitimize their own violent responses to your ideas. This is the love Trump's hate, when they go low, we go high party in action. What actually happens is when they don't get their own way, they start smashing shit up and calling you Nazis. Book burning while calling other people fascists. And the second thing that's happened, you know, to directly legitimize violence, which I'm glad there wasn't any of tonight, that there has been at other of my tour stops, is they will take you sort of, they'll give you two statements, and it's almost like a sort of bait and switch. They'll sort of convince you of something, and then they'll redefine a word in what they ask you to agree to, so you sort of find yourself agreeing to something awful without realizing it. So on the face of it, it's okay to punch Nazis. Well, yeah, I mean, if you have to punch someone. I mean, the first problem in America is you'd have to work really hard to find one, because there just aren't that many white supremacists left. I mean, I try to find them, I can't find any. To interview. Not for a book club. To interview. No, I mean, these mythological 20-year-old KKK anti-Semites I keep hearing so much about in the New York Times, I'd love to find one, just one. So they'll take you part of the way, they'll say, it's okay to punch Nazis, and you're sort of thinking, well, Richard Spencer got one on the side of the head, and I could live with that. But then they define everyone as Nazis. If you're slightly to the right of Jane Fonda, you're suddenly a fascist, a neo-Nazi, a white supremacist, and they offer no evidence whatsoever for any of these claims. And so it sets an enormously high bar if you're a conservative to get into public life in America. I'm not even from here, and within a year of me becoming as popular and successful as I am, I'm already being called the most appalling things on the basis of no evidence whatsoever. And they know they're not true. They know what they're saying isn't true. But they do it anyway as a sort of scare tactic to try and shut you up. Because they know that once they get you in a debate format, which, by the way, they never show up for, nobody will agree to debate me because they know they'll lose. It's this intimidation tactic that I think is coming to a close, that I think is coming to an end. I think the era of social justice is over, and I think 2017 is the year it fucking dies. These people know perfectly well that actual Nazis hate my guts, and they hate you and you hate them, but they're going to call you anyway for voting for the wrong... Careful if you get cancer, I mean, you know, you could be next. I don't know either. Anyway, we're here tonight to talk about something more sensitive. Somebody in the front row will probably know where I'm going already. We're here to talk about why America should stop murdering babies. Abortion isn't the same sort of demonic practice that you would find at one of Hillary's spirit cooking sessions. What? Boo what? But it is no less evil. Before we talk about some of the serious issues about abortion, I'll talk to you briefly about my faith. People always ask you questions. There's a sort of, oh, but aren't you gay? How can you be a Catholic? And there are a couple of answers to that. Somebody once said, you know, if you think I'm bad now, imagine how much how worse I'd be without God. and also, another of my favorites you know, the Catholic Church, which is the best religion. We know it's a church for sinners. You know, this is, somebody else once said, my memory's going today. What's wrong with me, sir? Somebody once said that people become Catholics because they know they're sinners. They become Anglicans, you know, what you most of you lot probably are, because they think they're righteous. There's some truth in there if you've ever met an evangelical preacher. You should always take what I say about religion with something of a grain of salt. I take the seven deadly sins as more of a guide to life than a set of injunctions. In fact, I like to check them off every day if I can, with the exception, obviously, of gluttony. But I am a Catholic, and I do believe in God, even as I recognize that the church is a church for sinners, and I'm probably one of the most enthusiastic sinners of all. In the Bible, it says we should be fruitful and multiply. I don't think it mentions abortions anywhere, but this is especially critical. It's especially critical subject at the time, civilizationally speaking, we are being outbred, to put it in animal terms. There are existential threats to our way of life growing everywhere in the world. Most obviously and most threateningly from the Middle East, from the Islamic world, where migration happens. Those families have many, many children. And in many cases, birth rates are dropping or evaporating in the West. And we aren't that very much far away from a situation like Japan. I mean, there may not be any Japanese people in three generations. They're just not having kids at all. And that seems to be, in terms of demographic trends, very much where we're headed in the West. Not that this is entirely simply a question of civilizational pragmatics, but it's worth considering that you can't win wars if you don't have anyone to fight them. Now, it's important to breed, especially if you have good genetics, which is why I'll finally be caving to public pressure and the millions of fan letters and auctioning off my sperm for charity. I'll be donating the proceeds to the Annapolis Privilege Grant. Just don't come asking for alimony, because I'm not a citizen, you'll never get it. I once wrote we had a wishing we had a religious right. Now, it sounds strange to you as Americans, and I would agree with you to a point, to be hankering after the religious right that did so much to mislead and to badger and to harangue and to bully people in the 90s. The religious right in the 90s were a problem. They were telling lies. They were saying video games could make you violent. Marilyn Manson could turn you into a school shooter. This was odious horseshit. It wasn't true. Just like when feminists say video games can turn you into a sexist. Bullshit. And the oppressors and the school mom-ish language policing kind of, you know, forces of darkness, the enemies of free speech, these days are progressives. These days are social justice warriors. But it wasn't that long ago when it was the religious right doing it. They've lost most of their influence now on American politics, and perhaps that's a good thing. Politicizing the faith has never worked out hugely well, particularly not in some of the in Middle Eastern countries I mentioned earlier. But at least we can say that you have a religious right that sticks up for the rights of people of faith. And where they become weak, you see the sort of grotesque injustices that make me cringe, like gay people parading boxes from Memory's Pizza like they got it on the sly, trying to violate people's religious consciences. And I find that embarrassing and ugly and humiliating, because I don't want everyone to think that gay people are all such preening cunts. It's my view that if you... Well, at least I do it in good suits. It's my view that if you have a religious conviction that prevents you from catering a gay wedding, you should be allowed to stand by that conviction. It's fairly appalling to see the media suck up to activist gays desperately trying to get attention, bullying perfectly good, ordinary, decent people. I went to visit the family that runs Memory's Pizza, and they were about the nicest people I've ever met. They were lovely. And if I felt bad for them. I felt that they'd been the victim of something very ugly and something very unfair. I'm not going to go on too long about religion, because I know that not all of you have the good fortune to be Christian, or even, if you're really lucky, Catholic. But there are a few important... Well, I want you to go to heaven. I do. I want you to go to heaven. I don't want you to be like the feminists. I want what's best for you. I'm pretty much, you know, like, I'm just giving up for myself, but I can save some of you. When the rest of you get down to hell, I'll already be running the place. But I want to take as many of you up there as I can. You know, there's only one sin that can never really be forgiven, voting Democrat. But, I think most people know instinctively. I think they intuitively understand that abortion is wrong and that it is murder. And I think that goes some way to explaining why abortion advocates are also angry. It's like, you know, you ever catch somebody in a lie and they get really mad at you, like really quickly, and you only realize later that they got really angry really fast because you caught them out. Well, there's something of that going on. There's something of that same sort of angry, empty fervor. And I think it has a name. I think that name is guilt. And we'll talk in a moment about what abortion does to the women, let alone what it does to the babies. When I say abortion is wrong, defenders leap to their feet and demanding to know why I want, for instance, this is a common catch they try to get you on. Why I want to jail a 10-year-old girl who has an abortion after someone rapes her. Well, guess what? I don't. And no defender of life, no pro-life advocate wants to jail that girl. Nobody does. It is an absurd straw man allegation, but people fall for it over and over and over again. I want to make a subtle distinction for you. And unlike feminists, my audiences are capable, are smart enough to enjoy the adventure known as reasoning with logic. And I make this distinction using the tools, by the way, of the Catholic Church, which has been reasoning gracefully since long before the first feminist had a hissy fit. Don't forget, by the way, the original feminists, Mary Wollstonecraft and Susan B. Anthony, denounced abortion too. Now, in principle, the Church teaches the direct, intentional taking of life is wrong. But that's a principle, and even in the most heartbreaking case, including the 10-year-old we're thinking about, it cannot be right to take the innocent life growing inside her, which has done nothing to deserve the death penalty. But as Western civilization has always understood, hard cases make bad law. You'll very often see, particularly in European countries, just desperate to ban anything. You know, if it exists, there must be rules about it. You know, it's like, this is how you can use it. I mean, every time I go back to Europe, there are more rules about everything. It's like, oh, no, you're using that pen wrong. What? Honestly, this is the French influence. You know, the French are a poison wherever they appear. You know, the French are this sort of cancerous thing in the middle of Europe. You know, most of the worst kinds of philosophy, the stuff that enables, legitimizes, underpins social justice and progressivism, all fucking French philosophers. All this post-structuralist, deconstructionist, relative fucking bullshit. Derrida and Foucault is a load of fucking horse shit. All of the worst stuff that underpins all of the worst, craziest visions of the universe, all French. And they collaborated with the Nazis, just saying. The Catholic Church, at least, has long been an enemy of utopianism. And utopianism is the most prominent vice of leftists. They think we should all be perfect immediately. They don't allow for human frailty or imperfection. And if you're not perfect, they throw you out the club. We've seen this with feminists who don't toe the party line on transgender pronouns. In other words, feminists who aren't mental. You know, Germaine Greer being the perfect example. They'll just cast you out of the club. I was cast out at birth, I think, from the gay club. I didn't have my gay card taken away. They never issued me with one because I've got the wrong politics. But this is how they are. Utopianism is a sort of leftist vice. They demand each of us must be perfect immediately according to their own warped vision of perfection. And it's a warped vision you'll find in gender studies classes and sort of Marxist gripe fests. Now here's the relevant distinction. I'm quoting from the Church's angelic doctor, Thomas Aquinas. Human laws do not forbid all vices from which the virtuous abstain, but only the more grievous vices from which it is possible for the majority to abstain. In other words, it's not wise to punish with human law everything that may be opposed to the natural one. That means that I can say it's okay to do something. I can say it's wrong to do something and it must not necessarily be ruthlessly and rigorously applied in every case. I can say it's wrong to take an innocent life without having to say that we should outlaw abortions in every single case. And almost nobody, in fact, does believe that. In a sane country, we would argue about what cases should be illegal. Should you, for instance, as often happens in non-Christian countries, allow abortions when The parents simply don't want a girl. Happens in China. Happens in the Middle East all the time. Here's one more fact that will help you understand that St. Thomas Aquinas and the Church aren't the killjoy Puritans that your lying professors claim. St. Thomas and before him St. Augustine both follow the anti-utopian view that I've just described when it came to prostitution. They thought it was wrong to do, but foolish to make illegal. I don't think they'd approve of rent boys, so my 20s probably still requires some apologizing for. But it is... I was young and I needed the money. But it is still an amazingly progressive position, given what you would expect to read. Once again, dead white men, much clearer thinkers than your leading lights. Since I brought up Catholicism, I do have to mention Islam a little bit. Now... Don't blame me. You blame George Lucas. He knew what he was doing. Don't try to tell me you didn't. Now, I do this partly because Islam is always wrong. Except for the female drivers thing. But I could pacify the liberals in attendance by saying it was mandated by the Diversity and Inclusion Department. No, we know abortion for sex selection has been common outside of Western civilization. The West is the best, and we have always been the best about everything, almost everything, almost all of the time. And we have never really suffered from sex-selective abortions. China's one-child policy. Many girls are aborted still today because the parents want a son. They need a son. They can have only got one shot at it. So just keep trying till you get a boy. By 2001, there are 117 boys born for every 100 girls, leading the government to outlaw sex-selective abortions in 2010, and outlaw doctors telling parents what sex their child would be. But of course, the Chinese are sneaky and skillful. Ignoring their authoritarian nanny state, they've come up with all kinds of ways around it. So these, you know, rub some strange dragon semen or something. You could find out whether it explodes in flames or not if it's a boy or a girl. Another culture, just kidding. They're very nice people. Another culture, love the Chinese people. Another culture that values sons far more than daughters is Islam. I've said on numerous occasions, if you're curious what effect mass Islamic immigration to the United States would have, all you need to do is look at Europe. All the signs are there. Statistical analysis of births in England, where I'm from. This is England. This is sort of in a modern cradle of civilization. Undertaken in 2014, recently, proved that thousands of young girls are being aborted for sex selection purposes. Now, the government and others wave their hands and try to explain these things, but a brave Greek man has stood up to them. Not talking about myself. There are other brave Greek men. This one is called Christophorus Agnastinopoulos, a lecturer in statistics who has just taken my crown for the most ridiculous Greek name around. Christophorus dug into the numbers and found certain incontrovertible proofs. Gender imbalances may be contributed by multiple factors, but no set of factors can explain away the imbalances in immigrant communities from Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Afghanistan. To quote him on the subject, the only readily available explanation is that consistent with a statistically significant gender shift of the sort observed in the census data is gender selective abortion. Which sort of makes you wonder how these pro-Islam feminists at that ridiculous DC march, led by a woman in a hijab, there's women's liberation for you, explain away their Muslim pandering, Islam sucking off tendencies. When everywhere there is Islam, you will find oppression of women and gender selective abortions. Thank you, madam. Under Islam, many girl babies simply never see the light of day. And if they do, it's in a tray, not in a crib. Feminists hate the truth, science, and logical thinking. Third wave feminism is entirely rooted in lies, distortion, and hysteria. It is a system of conspiracy theories. The wage gap, campus rape culture, these things do not exist. But they are fed to the public to justify misandry. Feminist arguments are no different. The underpinning of legal abortion in the United States is the Supreme Court case of Roe v. Wade. Now, many argue that this is shoddy law, but I'm not a liar. I'm not a lawyer. Sorry, Freudian slip. They occupy the same place in my brain, those two words. Unlike pundits on both sides of the debate. I'm not going to argue the Supreme Court for your entertainment. But I will share some unpleasant facts that sometimes get overlooked in this debate. The Roe in the name of the case was actually a woman named Norma McCorvey. Norma McCorvey is now an anti-abortion activist. And in the first place, she never had an abortion. Roe v. Wade, the child in that case, was given up for adoption. McCorvey now has three daughters of her own. She's admitted, as part of turning against abortion, that the entire case was a sham. In the case, she claimed to have been gang raped by thugs, which was a lie to make the case seem more sympathetic and get it to the Supreme Court. In fact, McCorvey claims that she had minimal involvement in the case beyond signing some papers. She was persuaded to play this part by feminist lawyers, by activist lawyers. McCorvey became an anti-abortion advocate after realizing the error of her ways. She bears a heavy heart. 50 million babies were legally killed following the passage of Roe v. Wade. Now, how can feminism be both pro-women and not be pro-motherhood? This is one of the enduring mysteries of the modern American left. There's nothing more unique about being a woman. There's nothing you can imagine that you could celebrate more, that you could cherish more about being a woman than the gift of motherhood. So much so that invariably when you hear about those male to female people, I don't know what you're allowed to say now. They change it so often. I can imagine how you guys feel. I have to do this stuff for a living and I don't know what the fucking right words are. Transgender's still okay, right. Well, we'll stick with cross-dresser, I think. Feminism loves abortion and loves to put down motherhood. It's a very strange kink, a quirk in feminist history. Consider that women's march in Washington. Besides a bunch of women leaving garbage and signs littered all over the city, because if there's one thing you can be sure of in a progressive protest is that they will absolutely trash the town. You know, the Tea Party used to have rallies and the fields were fucking spotless afterwards. Spotless! You see the pictures from the pro-life march that happened, which was smaller, but I mean the streets looked like they'd just been licked clean. They were cleaner when they left. Contrast that with the effluviant left on the streets from all those progressives, you know, sort of things leaching from every piercing. Madonna's bodily fluids. I just imagine her sort of wandering around leaking everywhere, you know? She's just one of those women you look at and she just looks like she's got stuff oozing out of everywhere, you know? She used to be so wonderful. Whatever happened to you? Anyway, Sue Ellen Browder, yet another abortion activist, who later became an anti-abortion activist, witnessed firsthand how the sexual liberation of the 60s and the 70s inserted abortion into the women's rights movement. She eloquently points out that what the media can't see is the national debate over abortion is not a war against women, but it's actually a war between women. And as any of you who have ever come into contact with a woman will know, so computer scientists, I'm sorry. Try to remember what your mother was like before she threw you out. Women might be mean and spiteful and vindictive to you, but they're even worse to each other. They're absolutely awful to each other, and nowhere is this more apparent, more obvious than the feminist movement, where they literally tear chunks out of each other all day for a living. Motherhood and child-rearing somehow became anathema to liberated women, and abortion became a prime component of so-called women's rights. Now, one of the main reasons abortion became synonymous with women's rights is the adoption of abortion, pun intended, into the political platform of the National Organization for Women. But I'd like to share a quote first from Betty Friedan, who was the president of NOW at the time, in 2001. You like her, huh? Slightly autistic, lone clapping in the middle. Everybody else is quiet because everybody else gets those subtle body language cues from me about when they're supposed to applaud, except this person is... Sorry. Computer science strikes again. I'm sorry, pumpkin. ideologically, says Betty Friedan, I was never for abortion. Motherhood is a value to me, and even today, abortion is not. I believe passionately in 1967, as I do today, that women should have the right of chosen motherhood. For me, the matter of choice has never been primarily the choice of abortion, but that you can choose to be a mother. That's as important as any right written into the Constitution. Now, if she said that today to a room full of third wave feminists, you know, after the hyperventilating had stopped, she'd be censored, kicked out, and possibly beaten up. Because feminists aren't pro-choice, they're pro-abortion. And in many cases, anti-woman. And you know, I find something interesting as a sort of, well, they call me a homophobic homosexual, which I'm not sure is entirely true. I don't like many other gays, but I do really like dick. So I don't know if I think they just mean I've got the wrong opinions for a gay, but I don't get nearly the sort of crap that, let's say, Ann Coulter or Michelle Bachmann, or the late Margaret Thatcher, or any woman who steps off ideological reservation. I have to admit, much as I would love to play the martyr, you know, tongue-in-cheek, obviously, even black conservatives don't get the sort of vitriol that's reserved for conservative women. And I think this has got something to do with what I was saying earlier about how women treat each other, the sort of viciousness and backstabbing that you sometimes see in, you know, between professional women. There's something particularly vile and terrifying about the language women reserve for each other. And this is what I mean. This abortion fight really is women on women violence, if you like. And if you are a woman who steps off the ideological reservation, if you're a woman who dares to extol the virtues of motherhood, if you're a woman who says, you know what, I'd quite like to stay home, quite like to have babies, quite like to raise a family, you're pathologized in today's culture. There's something wrong with you. There's something defective about you. Well, actually, half the women I know are like that. And way more than half of the men I know want a woman like that. So it's... you sound like you have experience with several of them. So if for no other reason then your desire to be happy and to make others happy, you should reconsider your position on this. Now, shout your abortion is another dark... it's another sign, I think, it's another instance in which this ugliness of the way that women treat each other can sometimes come out. And it's the sort of sociopathic side of the female psyche that is always so terrifying. Now, these initiatives are not about choice. When this thing started becoming popular, I mean, I would encourage, if any of you have very, very strong constitutions, or a bottle of Ipecac, and you know, a will to die, you should look this up on Twitter and see what some of the women say about the procedures that they have had. It will shock you. It will change you. I can't get away without sharing at least one Shout Your Abortion participant who said that her vacuum aspiration made her happy. That name just tickles her. You're vacuuming out the unwanted detritus threatening your aspirations. It's like blood drawn. She said she's had more painful experiences flossing. This is what killing a baby is to these people. Just a different version of flossing. And it's that same ugly, psychopathic instinct we see in social justice warriors generally, that same heartlessness, that same empty soullessness, the grinning face of evil, while at the same time pretending to be about rights, equality, diversity, and inclusion, but behaving in a manner that is utterly vile to other human beings. Shout Your Abortion and movements like it seek to normalize abortion, but in fact it's very bad for women's health. So if you don't care about the child, or you don't care to get involved in discussions about what stage it's okay, think about the women who have it done. In 2010, the Canadian Journal of Psychiatry published a study based on a sample of 3,000 women in the United States. The findings of this, the effects on abortion, are startling. Basically, it makes women crazy and suicidal. 59% increased the risks for suicidal thoughts. 61% increased risk for mood disorders. 61% increased risk for social anxiety disorders. 261% increased risk for alcohol abuse. 280% increased risk for any substance abuse. The only people, it seems, that benefit from abortion are Planned Parenthood and Budweiser. You see that Bud Light? Oh, I was so happy when sales of Bud Light went down. Went down after, what was it? Oh, God. That Super Bowl ad. As if anyone would want to be either of them. Advertising used to be aspirational. It used to be about people you wanted to be. You know, beautiful, skinny blonde girls, beautiful, jacked frat boys. Sorry. No, it used to be about aspiring to something. These days we have, I don't even know if we have a word for the opposite of aspiration. No, I don't think language has come up with it. Why would we ever need one? No, but these days, the people that we're encouraged to look up to, the people we're encouraged to find beautiful and brave, Amy Schumer, Lena Dunham, and Caitlyn Jenner, give me a break. In fact, the only... were you mooing or booing? I couldn't work it out. If the cause of this mental anguish were anything besides abortion, women would be marching non-stop against it. Madonna would be threatening to blow up the White House over it. Yeah, all right. Abortion is clearly so bad for women's mental health it falls second only to Islam. And maybe the fact that I'm gay. Thank you, Pumpkin. Imagine if the parents of your favorite people in this world had decided not to have them. Now, here's a list of people. I missed off all of the best people. These are the best people who ever lived. They're all the best people who ever lived. As Shakespeare, Wagner, if you don't know who that is, Lil Wayne, Mimi, and the God Emperor Daddy Trump. Of course, every once in a while, a celebrity comes along who makes you think abortion might not be such a bad idea. This is Perez Hilton. If only they could tell in the womb, you know? This is what they do, Carson Kressley and this prick. No wonder people don't come out. They think, oh God, you know, you're gonna be gay, you're gonna turn into one of those screaming queens, you know, angry about everything. Honestly, hell is other gay people. You have no idea how awful it is living as me. They're awful, they're really awful. Anyway, no, even Perez Hilton, I'm able to say selflessly, despite the fact that he just won't stop commenting on my Instagram recently, I'm able to say even Perez Hilton should have been given a fighting chance in life. Mother Nature had other ideas and made him look like that, but even he deserves a fair crack of the whip. Feminists, you know, actually, incidentally, I think that being gay, you sort of have to be pro-choice, don't you? Because if you believe in abortion, I mean, sooner or later they're going to be able to tell in the womb. I've never quite believed this born this way stuff. It seems to me 50-50, and all the science says it's 50-50. Everybody agrees it's 50-50. This born this way thing is basically marketing they invented in the 80s and the 90s. But if it is at least partially genetic, you'll be able to test for it in the womb soon. And when you can do that, you can introduce gene therapy to cure gay. Which on the face of it doesn't sound so bad. So I think if you're gay, you sort of have to be pro-life, don't you? At least if you ever want to suck off another 17-year-old. Kidding. No, I'd only do it in the Netherlands, where it's legal. No, I'm kidding. Do I look like I eat pizza? Feminists don't really handle science very well. They prefer feelings, so it's no surprise that despite mountains of evidence that abortion hurts women, and mountains of evidence that these small little people who have heartbeats and brainwaves and fingers no surprise that their abortion argument's proven wrong time and time again, but they just don't listen and they don't care. Let's start with the idea, as is often said by the most enthusiastic abortion advocates, that the baby's like a parasite inside the mother, attacking her body's integrity. You sometimes hear from radical feminists, they want to tear it out, you know. This is what many abortion advocates actually believe, that the woman's body is occupied by some kind of hostile force. And I think what's going on is they just don't like men very much, and they feel like this is something that has been done to them by a man, and they want to get rid of it, you know, to rid themselves of the guilt and shame they feel from sex. I think it's probably a lot of what's going on. But nothing could be further from the truth. In fact, babies pass beneficial cells to the mother, and those cells can aid in the mother's healing all her life. Having a child makes a woman stronger and healthier in almost every way. A fantastic book has been written on this subject by Jenna Pincott. It's called Do Chocolate Lovers Have Sweeter Babies? The Surprising Science of Pregnancy. I can hear from the titters in the back of the hall that some of you have identified me as a chocolate lover. Despite... Thank you. Despite my best efforts and the best efforts of my boyfriend, I still remain tragically unblessed, trying to get pregnant, still hoping. Another argument we hear all the time is that it's a woman's body and a woman's choice. Well, women, let us dispel this notion quite quickly. A baby is not your body. A baby, even at a quite early fetal stage, has her own heartbeat, her own brainwaves, her own separate DNA, distinct from yours. The different genetic code that is not the same as yours. But that baby is dependent on you, and it does rely on you for life, for at least for a while. How can you possibly argue that a baby is just a part of you? Babies inside their mother have everything besides fingerprints and social security numbers. Babies in the womb are the real undocumented Americans we should care about. Now, progressives like to insinuate that there is something sinister about big oil and big tobacco, and in rare instances, I suppose they may be right, but Planned Parenthood, or as I like to call it, big abortion, is even worse. We were all shocked when undercover tapes came out. My friend David Leiden sent his undercover team in there, showing that they are in the business of selling baby parts to the medical industry. Can you imagine, I don't think this is a stretch, imagine what happened. Imagine the sort of person sitting in the room when they were deciding, you know, what the right moment to advise a woman to have an abortion is so they can maximize the profit on those parts. Just imagine for a second what that room was like. That's the Democrat Party. It's horrifying, and it's what feminists want more of. Planned Parenthood can attribute a good portion of their baby-killing business to their president since 2006, Cecile Richards. Richards is well on her way to personally matching Hitler's body count. So we've done the grim math, so you don't have to. Using a conservative estimate of 300, that's a swastika by the Planned Parenthood logo, in case you know. There we go, now you got it. You see, we put a lot of care and attention into these things. Using a conservative estimate of 300,000 abortions, or, and this is one of the left's weird approaches to this subject, to try and persuade you, is to sort of butcher language. They either take it medical or take it in some way to kind of cover up what's really happening, you know, like female reproductive health. Who could argue with that? So they call abortions, by the thousand kilo scrapes. Using the technical metric measure, Cecile Richards has presided over 3 million abortions, or 3 mega scrapes, in her 10 years as president of the organization. This has earned her half-Holocaust status. Full Holocaust seems eminently reachable, given Planned Parenthood's growing hegemony in the abortion industry, unless Donald Trump defunds Planned Parenthood. Yeah. This is just since Richards took charge. Planned Parenthood has since 1970 performed 7 million abortions, comfortably surpassing Hitler in the organization's lifetime, according to its own annual reports. You have to admire the chutzpah, if you'll forgive that terminology. Planned Parenthood has amassed a Third Reich-style death count, legally, while pocketing $500 million to do it. But under Richards, the numbers have skyrocketed such that in the last 10 years, at least 3 million young lives were ended. If she stays in her post another decade, she'll easily reach full Hitler. The road ahead may be rocky. Besides the undercover videos that were leaked, some media sources are starting to cover the revolting practices of these sociopathic monsters. Nice, normal people, whatever their views on abortion, have no stomach for charnel houses like these. And perhaps, as I say, President Trump will do the right thing. If you need to hear more, by the way, but I always find it interesting to find out what the people were like who founded these organizations. Margaret Sanger, the founder of Planned Parenthood, was unarguably and hideously racist. She spoke glowingly about a presentation she gave to a group of KKK women in New Jersey, and they loved her messaging about the black race so much that they asked her to come back. Messaging like this, which she wrote in a letter to Dr. Clarence Gamble. She said, "We do not want word to get out that we want to exterminate the Negro population. And the minister is the man who can straighten out the idea if it ever occurs to any of their more rebellious members." Look, notice that, like the proto-social justice warrior, the proto-progressive that she is and she was, she considers minorities that disagree with her to be rebellious or uppity. Black Trump supporters heard these words, and much worse, during the campaign. Margaret Sanger's goal, of course, was to diminish the black race, and one can argue she was at least partially successful. Stats about abortion by race are not always easy to find, because of course they're not. But nonetheless, they paint a compelling picture about the race reality of abortion. New York City presents itself as a strong case study. In 2012, there were more black children aborted in New York City than there were black children born alive. It was 31,000 compared to 25,000. More aborted than born. Blacks accounted for 42% of the abortions in the city, while Hispanic women accounted for another 31%. That's 73%. Three quarters of all abortions that kill black and Hispanic babies. Other national data for the Center for Bioethical Reform assert that black women are three times more likely to have an abortion than white women. So isn't it fascinating, that intersectional third wave feminists fighting for abortion are so often seen arm in arm with Black Lives Matter? To any BLM members tucked away in the audience, I can conclusively say that feminists are the one group who do not believe that Black Lives Matter at all. Whether you believe in an immortal soul or not, babies are precious. You may not like some of the grim imagery associated with the anti-abortion movement, and you may find the pictures of dead babies carried by protesters and issued out to the audience this evening distasteful. That is the point. Abortion should be considered terrible. The left knows it, and that's why they do their best to make people think babies are just magical clumps of cells that magically become humans as soon as they exit the woman's body. They prey on vulnerable women who are pregnant, while at the same time brainwashing young people to praise abortion. I'd like to remind you that many of the great people in history were born as orphans or adopted. Julius Caesar, Bach, Steve Jobs, Aristotle, Louis Armstrong, Marilyn Monroe, John Lennon, Bill Clinton. Never mind. Well, I don't know. I mean, without him, we'd never have had sick Hillary's campaign, so. I'd like to suggest to you, if you're in this room, and to the many thousands of people watching at home, reject the cultural conditioning favoring abortion. Reject these extreme and bizarre contortions of language that the left likes to indulge in. Female reproductive health is a euphemism for something much worse, and it exists in the same category of expressions as final solution. You've already rejected so much. You've rejected campus rape epidemic mythology, gender pay gap lies, and conspiracy theories. I'm asking you to go a little further because common decency, morality, and Western civilization need you. There's been a huge resurgence in conservative and libertarian activism, thanks to Donald Trump, that culminated in his presidency. And I've been proud and happy to sort of not just document it, but give it a kick up the ass on college campuses too. This is a moment when, if you have strongly held beliefs, you are finally able to express them. This is a moment in American culture that's very important. This window now that you have, and it's not just about abortion, but free speech in general, small state, any of the other things that you might believe in. Your right, most importantly, to be left the fuck alone and not be told that your hairstyle is racist and your language is sexist and the books you read are unhelpful. All this shit. This is a moment. This is a moment in culture where you can stand up and say enough, no more, because you have demonstrated through voting for someone like Donald Trump who many of us would not have imagined finding a plausible candidate for president even 3 months ago. Kidding. Somebody like Donald Trump, a very unexpected sort of candidate for president, you have demonstrated there are enough of you now. You have safety in numbers. If you believe that you should be left alone by progressives and social justice warriors and feminists and Black Lives Matter activists and the Democrat Party, if you believe that you know better than the government does how to look after yourself, what you should be allowed to say, where you should be allowed to go. If you believe in any of the principles that conservatives and libertarians have been forced to concede on and concede on and concede on because they were scared of being called racist, scared of being called sexist, scared of being called homophobic, scared of being called whatever, whatever, whatever. This is your moment now. This is a moment not just for you to take back the White House, which matters a bit, but more importantly for you to take back culture. Politics is downstream from culture. As the late Andrew Breitbart used to say, the guy who founded the website that I now work for, politics matters, but it is a symptom. The root cause is culture. And you must now go forward and take this opportunity that has been given to you because it will not come around again. Fix academia. Show, you know, with your purchasing decisions that the entertainment industry and the news business cannot lie to and lie about you egregiously for decades without consequence. Go out there and be proud conservatives and libertarians, and do not ever again take someone else's word for how you should live your life, and do not ever again allow the social justice left to run this country and to run it into the ground. You know, as conservatives who believe in the Constitution, as libertarians who believe in freedom, you are uniquely situated now in a presidency that is just making the left's heads explode. They're totally consumed with Donald Trump. This is your moment. This is the time you fight back. This is the time you stop going to movies when they are egregiously pushing their politics on you, which I know you did with Ghostbusters. Vote with your feet. Stand up. And remember to have fun, because there's nothing that authoritarians hate more than the sound of laughter, because they can't control it. They can't control what you find funny, and that scares them. And that's why they try. That's why they clamp down on humor first. That's why they go for the comedians. That's why Chris Rock and Jerry Seinfeld won't play on college campuses. Spineless cunts. It is precisely a comedian's job to push the envelope. When you call yourself a comedian, you can say almost anything and people won't come for you because you're seen as occupying a uniquely valuable space in culture. American comedians have totally abnegated, totally and completely given up their responsibility to tell hard truths and to speak truth to power because their side of the political argument now they are the powerful. That is the power. Well, you now have an opportunity, a very rare opportunity, a last gasp, last ditch window of a couple of years to take that power back. I encourage you to do it. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. I'm happy to take some questions. I think Andrew's going to run to you with the microphone. If you, is that right? Yeah? Okay, put your hands up if you'd like to ask a question. Yes, you, the first person right in front of me, yes. Yeah, if he gives it to the end of the row, you can run it along. And then wait until you have it so everyone can hear you.
What advice do you have for a conservative student living in a...
Sorry, it's actually compliment question.
You're a very handsome
kidding,
man.
I'm kidding.
What advice do you have for a conservative student living in a predominantly liberal area?
Mm-hmm. I would say pick your battles wisely. You don't want to have your educational future put at risk by activist professors, and there are lots of them. My general sensible top line advice is keep your head down, get a good grade, and live well as the best revenge, because you can always donate money later to things that will make a difference once you have a beautiful car, a hot wife, and a wonderful house somewhere. You won't get any of those things if you allow them to destroy your education. You don't get the grades. By the same token, a window is opening up now where you can, if you are so moved, resist slightly. And I would encourage you to do it with good humor. Do it with a smile on your face. Don't allow them to characterize you as anything but a mischief maker. I always say this. I say this in every Q&A I ever do, and it's the most important thing, I think, really, that I can ever tell anyone, is that nobody can resist the truth wrapped in a good joke. You know, nobody can ever resist somebody who makes them laugh. And it's enough of a heresy on college campuses merely to ask questions these days, to provide alternative data. That can be enough. that you don't have to, you know, go all out wearing those hats around campus and getting yourself beaten up and blacklisted by professors, though I'm so glad you do. So if you want some advice, it's keep a smile on your face, because your opponents are angry, very angry, mostly because they know they're about to lose. They know that they have enjoyed 30 years of unqualified power, of unaccountable hegemony, and they realize now that the jig is up, that people have seen, they've seen little windows into this. University of Missouri, some of the worst things that feminists say. People have begun to see past, you know, behind the curtain. And they haven't liked it very much. They've seen what Black Lives Matter says versus what Black Lives Matter does. They've seen what feminism says versus what feminism does. So the activists are becoming very angry. It is, in fact, the defining characteristic. And if you can sit back and laugh with a smile on your face, nothing will annoy them as much. Let's go to this wonderful outfit here. How could I say no to this marvelous ensemble? I do so like it when people dress up properly.
Milo, thank you for coming, first of all.
You're
really
welcome,
appreciate it. As an oppressed Middle Eastern male that sexually identifies as an attack helicopter.
Yes.
Which you actually microaggressed against me in the beginning. Don't think I didn't catch that.
I'm sorry for that microaggression. I will add to that microaggression a man spread.
Check your privilege. Check your privilege.
They always talk about men sitting like that. Do they mention their fucking handbags? Use up every other bloody chair. Every chair. Even if I give my friends a lift, you know, and their sort of handbag, shopping bag, do I complain? No.
So you should know that places me rank number one on the progressive stack, right, guys? Mm. Right? Okay, good. So, basically, my question is that what red-pilled you to get out of the matrix, so to speak, of the regressive left? So for me, I just want to add that it was listening to outspoken professors at college like Jordan Peterson, Jonathan Haidt, and Gad Saad.
Yes, great. He's almost as... I love Gad, but he has an ego almost the size of mine, so he'll be very happy that he's getting enthusiastic responses from at least one person this evening.
As well as from two YouTubers, specifically Sargon of Akkad and Computing Forever. Great guys.
Yes, all very good, very good, very good. Thank you. I don't know, I was sort of born wrong. I think I was born as a contrarian. I'm a good weather vane for where the power is in society, because I think if I'd been born 30 years earlier, I'd be doing what I'm doing now, but directed at the religious right. I basically have always been a sort of dissident, iconoclast, free speech fundamentalist, and I always wanted, if somebody ever told me not to do something, I would find out a way to do it and not get caught. And then later in life, when I had money and position, I'd find a way to do it and make sure everyone saw. just to demonstrate that nobody, you know, that I can, and that, you know, most of the rules that they make for you are bullshit, and nothing bad happens if you break them. And as a sort of natural rule breaker, it's just my psychology, really, and missing those bits of my brain where normally people feel fear, guilt, shame. I suppose I just always wanted to upset I wanted to prod the biggest fish, if you like. I wanted to upset the most powerful people. And I recognized quite early in my life that the most powerful people were not who we were being told. They weren't conservatives. They weren't the churches. They weren't any of the people that we were told. It wasn't the patriarchy. Because I looked at the numbers, I looked at the data, and I was like, well, hang on a second. If get rid of all the media and politics, but just look at how the world actually is. What would I rather be born as? Well, it would be a wealthy white woman in America, because they're the most privileged group that have ever existed in the history of human civilization. And yet, millions of them marching, claiming to be oppressed by some guy who just wants to shut the border. This is lunacy. This is insane. This is a sort of fantasy and reality. This is as otherworldly to me as Buffy the Vampire Slayer. I mean, that's like how far removed from reality this thing is. And so I decided that I just wanted to provoke and ridicule and challenge all of the gatekeepers of good taste and received opinion, and to show other people that the majority of what they were saying wasn't true, and also to demonstrate to people that you can break just about, or you can break or bend to snapping just about any rule that they give you, and not very much bad happens.
And lastly, excuse me, I wanted to point out that I really appreciate your good conscience and praise you for it, that you freely give out the microphone to students, even though many times, as we see in the videos you have, that they not only yell at you, but they also try to disrupt your speech and end it. Now, let me say, to compare to your counterpart, of the tolerant lefts, the fat, brown buffalo that we know as Cenk Uygur of the Young Turks. We see what they did 2 months ago about in CSU Northridge. They had a Q&A session where at the end of it, they have the staff attendant. They don't give the microphone. They do this. They do this for the student because they don't trust them in case they ask
No, they run scared.
Yeah,
And you only do that, why? If you're scared of the fact.
In case you ask
only do that if you're worried about losing. I'm not worried about losing. I'm already one of life's losers. You know, I was born gay. I've got nothing to lose.
I love you.
I'm done. So I've got nothing. You know, it's Oscar Wilde. You know, we're all born in the gutter, but some of us are looking at the stars. These people think they have a position to maintain that is dependent on them never being embarrassed. But when you take shame away from the enemy as a weapon, you become, in the words of that man who cruelly parodied Muslims earlier, more powerful than you can possibly imagine. You become unbeatable when you refuse to allow them to shame you. And that is what... this comes from many different places in culture, but I got it from drag queens. You know, you tell... Well, if you listen to rap, Eminem does this well. If you've been in any way, you know, a participant in gay culture, you get it from drag queens. But if you tell whatever jokes they're going to make about you about yourself first and way funnier, they've got nothing left. They have nothing. You know, if you call yourself everything they might come for you with, and make fun of yourself and humble yourself before people, as I try to do, you know, telling endless jokes about black dick at my own expense. Well, I do it for a reason. I do it because I want you to know it's okay to laugh at me, and if I can then laugh at you, then we can actually have a real conversation, you know, versus the left, which is so scared of humor, because it believes that jokes are a way that people to subtly express sexism or subtly express racism. They're so ill-educated in basic human nature, they don't understand that humor is actually how we connect, and humor is how we relate to one another, and humor is how we establish relationships, not how we break them up. But Karen, sorry.
I'm almost done. You didn't let me get to the best part.
Go ahead.
The best part was, he happened, one of the students, to ask a very nutty question, and of course it was about Armenian genocide, so...
Yes, he denies it, doesn't he?
Yes, yes, they do, and... Or at least they try to always avoid talking about it. But as soon as he said that, they pulled the microphone away, they cut to commercial break, and they escort him out. And I can say I am proud that you have not done that, and I applaud you for this.
And I never will. And I never will. I'd love to be proven wrong about something, mainly because I'd like to know how it feels. I welcome inquiry. I welcome challenge. Just I just wish they were a bit smarter. I think I can do another couple. Okay. Let's pick somebody from the back. The person with both hands up is not getting a question for being too keen. No, I'm kidding. Yeah, I'm kidding. You can have it. You can have it. Thirsty. Nobody likes a thirsty bitch.
Hello, Milo.
Hi, Pumpkin.
I put both hands up because usually you like energy in your audience.
I do. It was very high energy. It was a high energy wave.
I did my homework.
I rewarded you, but I had to roast you slightly at the same time.
It's okay.
What he gives with one hand, he takes away with the other.
Right. Well, me and my friend here, we drove 4 hours to go see you because your shows in LA got canceled.
Thank you.
But
thank you so much.
It was well worth it. It was definitely well worth it.
Thank you.
And... I'm really glad I got to see this one because, to me personally, as a Catholic, because Catholics are the best, this speech in particular is probably one of the most favorite that you've given so far.
Thank you. My speeches are all my favorite. Every one I give is better than all the others, so it becomes my new favorite. My favorite speech is always the one I just delivered. But I'm happy that you like this one.
They're all equal, but this one is more equal. So. Yeah. All right. Well, anyways, Something that I was wanting to ask you, because I've been blessed and I've never had to really deal with any regressives really so much where I go to school. I wanted to know your opinion on this. How many people who buy into the leftist regressive ideology actually buy into it? How many of them are in it for personal gain, maybe like Hillary? How many of them buy into it because they simply don't know any better? And it's sort of like a follow-up question. Out of the people who actually buy into it, how many of them are doing it out of spite, and how many have good intentions?
Okay. Well, if you're asking me to give a sort of taxonomy of the progressive left, that isn't just, oh, bonkers, I would say there's enormous social pressure to conform to whatever is perceived as the sort of prestige opinions of the day. And this is known to sociologists as preference falsification. So, in other words, you say, yes, I'm a feminist, to have an easy life, because you know that everybody else does that. Now, interestingly, preference falsification is supposed to exist among the less well-educated. But in America, it exists exclusively among the best educated. So ordinary people are perfectly happy to admit they're not feminists. 4 out of 5 women say, mm-mm. But you'd be hard-pressed ever to find a journalist on either side of the political divide, except, you know, the right-wingers who are trying to make a point out of it. You'd be hard-pressed to find a woman or a male journalist, frankly, to say that they're not a feminist. And this is a sort of peer pressure. And I think that peer pressure, that preference falsification, accounts for perhaps 75% of the social justice left. And that's why I have hope. That's why I'm optimistic. Because if you see the next generation coming up now who were, you know, people my age are the problem. I'm 32. People my age are the real problem. It's the apex of social justice at my age. Well, people my age are having kids now. And those kids, as part of the natural cycle of rebellion and renewal, are starting to grow up. They're 13 or whatever, and they really hate BuzzFeed. They really hate BuzzFeed. And they write to me all the time, like 14, 15-year-olds, saying, my mum would kill me if she knew I watched you on YouTube. And I'm like, this is great. This is wonderful. This so completely did the left dominate culture, you know, politics, but also, more importantly, academia, the entertainment industry, and the news business. And they still do, by the way, all three of those fields. That for my generation, it's almost obscene to say you're not a feminist. It's almost obscene to say you don't support Black Lives Matter. But that cannot possibly be deeply rooted sincere conviction. It must be something else. And what it is, I think, is preference falsification. Now, the reason this gives me hope, the reason this is good, first of all, 3 out of 4 of them don't really believe it. They do it for an easy life, or they do it because it's what everybody else is doing, or they do it for professional advancement, or they just sort of reflexively do it because if everyone thinks I must be roughly right. Because most people aren't critical thinkers. Most people don't take the sort of forensic approach to their own belief systems that I hope that most of you do and that I try to do. Most people don't really think, don't give this stuff that much thought. But what preference falsification leads to is something called a preference cascade. And this is what we saw at the end of the Cold War when the Berlin Wall came down. This is what we see very often when suddenly something happens to trigger a mass conversion to the other side. And this is the fall of communism, basically. Suddenly, you know, you had all these countries that were like, yeah, we love our government, everything's great. You know, because there's fear of social censure, there's fear of punishment, all these kind of, all these social incentives are pointing in one direction, but when the curtain is lifted, when the wall comes down, suddenly people either flip instinctively or just revert to their natural positions. When communism fell, suddenly you discovered all these new small business owners. Well, I thought you were a happy communist. Well, so you've just started with Trump's election. This is why I said you've got a window now that will not come again. Because if you miss it this time, America's basically fucked, sorry to say. If you don't get this one, by the time the next one comes around in another 30 or 40 years, it will be the Islamic State of America, and you will have no chance. But I've just started to see clues. I've been doing this for a little while now, and I've never had as much hope as I have now. BuzzFeed videos, you know, what I think when I hear the word white. And you're like, oh God, I don't even need to see this, do I? And it's exactly as bad as you imagine, but it's got an equal number of downvotes to upvotes. This has never happened before. BuzzFeed internally are horrified by this. They keep wondering, I have a few sort of undercover friends there, and they say that the big problem for BuzzFeed isn't just that they steal people's content and try to make it a business model, which is ultimately unsustainable, or that their insane, crazy social justice politics turning everybody off. It's a generational problem. They captured the imagination of millennials, but the people coming up younger, 12, 13, 14-year-old, fucking hate them and don't watch their stuff and downvote it. So BuzzFeed's creating this huge entertainment, you know, franchise platform system for young people, and young people don't like it. It's a generational thing. And I started to notice other things. I mean, Trump's election is an example of this. People are prepared to overlook things they really can't stand, and there are plenty of reasons to, plenty of respectable, reasonable, decent people who don't agree with me that, that Donald Trump is the greatest living human being. Daddy. Plenty of reasonable, respectable people don't agree with me about that, and I respect their opinions. But they voted for him anyway. They sort of held their nose and voted for him. Why? Because they were so desperate to put the social justice warriors back in their place. And because something about his rallies, something about the size, the energy of those crowds, encouraged people to believe that they weren't alone. And not just they weren't alone, but they might even be in the majority. And that's, those are the conditions under which a preference cascade happens. It's my, my curse is that I'm an optimist. It is my hope, I think I'm not wrong about very much. I think, maybe anything. I was wrong once in like 1984, five maybe. It's my hope that this sort of preference cascade has been triggered by Trump, and you'll start to see the ramifications in culture. You'll start to see more comedians like Bill Burr and Joan Rivers popping up on Netflix because they'll just have to. They'll just have to. I'll have to cater to the demand that's out there. You'll start to see more. I mean, I think that it was very brave of my publisher, for instance, to take me on, given what they must have known would happen. And you know, shot to number one on the Amazon bestseller list within 24 hours. Thank you so much. But this is my point. This is my point. There's an appetite now. There's an appetite. And I think if you can really run, if we can run into this unafraid of their shaming tactics, of their name-calling, just burst through, you know, being as outrageous and silly and fun-loving as possible, I think there's a real chance to break the yoke. So I think, it's a very long answer to a very short question, but I think the real die-hard social justice warriors are just emotionally damaged people who have been empowered by culture to make the rest of us hurt as much as they're hurting. And the kind, compassionate thing to do would be to give those people therapy and drugs and keep, you know, take them out of government, out of the media, and out of the movie business. Because they're not helping anyone. They're only hurting the rest of us while they, you know, continue to suffer themselves. And we have arrived at a point in American culture where the inmates are running the asylum, where the worst qualified people are lecturing the rest of us on how to live. That has to change. And I think with Trump's election, it might. Let's do one more. Yeah, sure. Oh, come on now. No, he gets
hey, everybody. Hey,
minus two for yelling in
hey.
That
okay,
in
sorry.
That unpleasant vulgarian manner.
Sorry, I'm
but
so
plus
sorry.
Three for speaking up in this audience. So yes. on balance, I gave it to you.
All right, so you say that the era of social justice is over, and you
yes.
complain about social justice work. So I want to ask a question. To what extent do you feel that labor market discrimination exists right now against gays and lesbians or African Americans, for example? And if you do believe that it's quite prevalent, what should be the role of the state in responding to it?
Well, in general, the role of the state should be nothing. But I was very relaxed. What? Well, I was about to give you a serious answer, but you can go fuck yourself. Let's have someone else. Let's go. Yeah, let's go over here. Yeah, you. No, I don't throw people out. I allow them to make fools of themselves. They do it beautifully. I will answer it briefly. I was very happy and very relaxed to see the LGBTQIIA like page disappearing from the White House website. We're doing fine. We're doing absolutely fine. You know, nothing's perfect, but there are much, much bigger problems in America to fix than a couple of, you know, homosexuals still claiming they're discriminated against when not really. I think there is a problem with the black community, but it's got much more to do with education than jobs. People, you know, it's very tough to find a racist these days. People will just hire the best guy for the job. The problem is that, you know, many black people don't have the educational opportunities, and I think that rather than trashing their own towns, they should be focused on building better schools. Don't scold me again. No, I said I'd do one more, so I'll do the guy in the sweatshirt. Oh, God. This isn't a democracy. I don't want to fuck you. I don't have to do shit. I'm not like other college speakers. I don't have to be nice to you. I don't have to be nice to anyone. Fine, go on. And since your voice carries so beautifully, we'll spare you the mic and you can yell from there. Go ahead.
I think you'll like the story.
Okay.
Do you want me to tell you the boy story first or the other one? No, just kidding. The boy toy story?
Well, try and keep it brief and pop a question.
All right, so my day started with a visit from the Secret Service at 11:45 in the morning.
Today?
This morning.
What did you do, Pumpkin?
Well, I was exercising my right to free speech on Facebook rather eloquently. Mm.
What did you do? What did you say? Tell us.
I was very critical of some of the social policies of our current president. I'm a social liberal.
You don't need to go current. He's just the
conservative.
President.
I'm very fiscally conservative, but I'm social liberal. So I'm sort of on the libertarian end of things.
Very respectable position.
So, and I'm pretty thoughtful about stuff, so I was kind of rambling about this, that, and the other. So I got a call from the Secret Service.
Right.
And the good news is that they walked out apologizing and saying that they wish they had people like me working for them. Mm-hmm. The bad news is that I got the phone call in first place.
Yes.
So I just wanted to say that... I appreciate what you are doing for that very valuable right that we have of free speech, and that diversity of ideas is probably the most important thing that we should all learn to appreciate. And even though I don't agree with everything that you say, I welcome everything that you say. So here's the thing about the... Given that the topic today was about abortion, and I'm a woman, I've never had an abortion, I think that it's not a either-or decision. It's not for the government to tell women what they should and should not do, and it's not for anybody to moralize women for their choices. I think it's ultimately the woman that has to decide what she wants to do and live with that choice. Mm. Because I agree with the statistics
I mean, we have very different positions. I think it's fine to criminalize and to moralize about any kind of murder, including that one. So we have different positions. That's perfectly okay. I don't, for instance, hand it over to a murderer's private conscience, whether they're allowed to go around murdering people in the street. I don't hand it over to a burglar's private conscience, whether they should be permitted to simply rob people.
If you take
the view that I do, which is that this is just another one of those crimes, then clearly there is a role for some kind of
The way I agree with you, actually, but at the same time, I see how we're trying to choose between two wrongs. Which one is the less wrong? Is it less wrong to kill the fetus, or is it less wrong to give a woman a choice? And it's a very philosophical thing rather than a government. Like, the government can't get involved in labor disputes, like you said. Shouldn't get involved in my personal beeswax either.
Fine. Then we shouldn't fund it either.
We're not.
I'll take your position as far as so clearly you want to defund Planned Parenthood. We have at least one point of agreement then.
Actually, they're not funded by the government. It's not a line on the budget on the government. It's a reimbursement.
All right.
It's a Medicare thing.
No.
I just did the research.
Be respectful. People are allowed to be wrong. It's okay.
And beautiful, right?
I think we're going to have to draw a line under it there. Thank you so much. I appreciate your contribution and everybody else's. Thank you for being such a wonderful audience. I appreciate it. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. This one. Thank you.
Come in, lady.